as the word gets out that physicians could be involved in this, and especially oncologists, we want them to use this as an additional tool in their toolbox, if you will. You know, giving them some more skills and education on what to do to deal with patients who are facing end-of-life decisions. And even people who are coming in, you know, a person coming into the cancer center with advanced disease, we know that the end result will be their death. How do we start planning for that right from the beginning? How do we involve ourselves in palliative care to help things like pain, nausea, vomiting, the fear of death, advanced care planning, all those sorts of issues that we see. What we want the doctors and nurses to look at is to say, where are those opportunities to start talking about things like symptom management, care decisions? What are the goals of care out of all of this? When we have a young person come into the cancer center, those goals are going to be different than an 85-year-old woman or man who's, you know, truly nearing the end of their lives and hopefully has thought about this. A person that's 40 years of age, given a diagnosis of pancreatic carcinoma, their life now is incredibly shortened. We can talk about anywhere from 6 months to 2 years that they may live. So what do you do during those 2 years? You know, you can't fit 40 years worth of life into that. How do we change the focus? How do we assign what goals you'd like to get out of here? Do I want to spend more time with the family? Do I want to really work hard, fight hard, using chemotherapy to get as much time as possible? And those are the sorts of discussions we'd like the professionals to have. Sometimes that's difficult for professionals because their whole training has been chemo, 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 or radiation, radiation, radiation. And by focusing in on the disease rather than the person, you're missing, you know, it's the whole forest for the trees sort of thing. And we're trying to say, okay, step back, look at this. This is another person who's there. Deal with some of the issues that are important to them, not your own agenda. Conversations around transitioning or the looking at palliative care as the next option are very difficult. They're very difficult for oncology professionals especially, because a lot of our work has been use the chemotherapy, cure the cancer. Sometimes some of my colleagues feel that if the cancer is not cured, they take it as a personal failure. So they start to feel badly for the patient or the family. I think it's important to start with just saying, you know, we've done a pretty good job here. We've been able to treat the cancer for a period of time. Where do you think things are at? You know, probably about 90% of patients feel that things are changing, and they want that to be acknowledged. Rather than some people say, or some colleagues will say, things look good, we'll see you in 3 months, well knowing that they've only got a month to live, so it's not my problem. Which, you know, patients then feel kind of abandoned. No one's really come out and said what's going on. And I think it's important to be honest. So if the patient says, I really think the cancer is progressing, yes, the cancer is progressing. I'm interested in knowing how much longer I have, what are the things that are going to happen to me. By starting that conversation, by saying to patients, I think that the cancer is changing, we should start thinking about looking at the quality of life rather than quantity. This eventually will shorten your life, you will die from this cancer. Those are things that they don't want to hear, but at the same time, they want to hear. You know, that you don't want to leave them and say, well, things look good, we'll see you later on, and then they just, there's no roadmap. You know, they're a bit of lost in the forest. What are they supposed to do? Who are they supposed to call? And also that focus changes. Before they were focusing in on the chemotherapy and everyone would be excited or anticipating what would happen at the next appointment. What did the CT scan show? What are the blood tests showing? Then the focus changes. Then you have to kind of say, okay, how are things today? How, you know, what happened through the day? How's your energy? How's your appetite? How are the things that are affecting you most? How do you, you know, when do we start to sit down and make plans for the future? What does the future look like? What are the goals that you want out of this? You know, we're trying to get her to live instead of just die. And I think that's probably the focus that too often our colleagues get into. I'm sorry, the cancer's worse. There's no chemotherapy. You're just going to die. So you've got this dying stage, when really what we should be doing is living. living to the best of our ability. Because eventually you will die, you know, and there's a period of time I can predict and I can tell the patients what's going to happen at that time. But we could have a period of time, you know, several weeks, several months, that you do wonderfully. You feel like a human again and you can actually do things. If the question is, how long do I have, I always want to confirm that they're talking about the same thing, that we are on the same page. So how long do I have? How long do you have until you die? How long do you have until lunchtime? How long do you have until I get home? Because people have different things in mind, and I really need to know, because the answers are going to be different. A colleague said once, person said, how long do I have? And he went into the spiel about, you only have 3 months to live, you're going to die, this is the way that you're going to happen, everything else. And he was actually wanting to just, when am I out of this hospital? So he got more than he bargained for. But I think it's important when you do that, you also want to find out, what do you think is going on? Or, you know, you want to find out what the patient is considering. What's their fears? What are their worries about things? I know that textbooks give us information. They give us numbers and things. We can look at papers and research, and they can give us more numbers. But inevitably, those numbers are for groups rather than individuals. And what I like to do is phrase it to the patient, I can't give you a day and a date, I can't give you the time, but I can say, just based on what we've seen, patients like you, we could be talking about weeks to months, or maybe days to weeks, or hours to days, depending upon where they are in the trajectory. Sometimes I don't even say that. I say, you know, I really can't tell right now. You're doing very well, the chemotherapy is working, your disease is responding. We know that if sometime in the future it may stop responding, at that time we'll talk about more about it. But I want you to, if you have any concerns, I want you to bring them up so we can discuss them. And I think that's, you know, opening that door, keeping that door open is an important thing for the patient. You're absolutely right, the patient doesn't necessarily want to know, but they also don't want to be kept in the dark. Let's put it that way. So if I look at them and I know we're dealing with them in the last few weeks, they don't want me to say, well, you got lots of time to live. And often what I'll do is I'll look at holidays. So we've just had Thanksgiving. There are people who I will say, I don't think you're going to be here for Christmas. Don't plan for Christmas. Or did you have a nice Thanksgiving? You saw all the family. That's really good. How do you think things are going to go, and where, you know, how much time do you think? And then I'll either confirm or say, no, I think it's going to be even shorter than that. And sometimes people come in and they surprise you. You know, you say, I think we're going to be talking about weeks, and then, you know, several months go by, a year goes by, and you say, boy, I was wrong. But they know that they've come close, so they have an idea of what it is that they're looking at. And again, I like to kind of sit down and re-examine it with patients as they come along.